Well, first of all, thank you, GT, for inviting me and giving me the opportunity to talk about something that's been the focus of my life for the past 30 years, which is the field of epigenetics. And I'd say when I first started in this field, it was sort of a small niche field within the field of genetics. Everybody in genetics thought this is really interesting, but they didn't know how it applied to what they did in genetics. And now, two or three decades later, there are probably there are tens of thousands of papers on epigenetics now. And everybody who wants to be doing something interesting is say they're an epigeneticist. So all of a sudden, we went from nothing in a sort of a quiet little field to a field that's become quite popular and quite interesting. And the field is so gigantic now that I can't tell you everything about the field. In fact, my postdoc and I just wrote a book chapter on epigenetics environment, the topic I'm going to talk about today. And the field is so big, I had to narrow down for that chapter what I'm going to talk about, and I'm going to have to do the same thing here today. So I'll give you sort of a brief snippet and hopefully a feel for what epigenetics is and how it affects us short-term and particularly long-term affects our long-term disease susceptibility and disease risk. So that'll be my primary focus, particularly effects of environment and diet and nutrition. So I start out usually by talking about this commentary or article from Andy Feimery's lab at Hopkins in the Journal of the American Medical Association. So that sort of gives you a perspective of the relevance of genetics. So what he wrote is, and I just took a small snippet, epigenetics, the study of non-sequence related heredity, is at the epicenter of modern medicine because it can help explain the relationship between an individual's genetic background, the environment, aging, and disease. Okay, so that's sort of the perspective of what I'm going to talk about. So what is epigenetics? The formal definition, which is not very accessible except to another epigeneticist, is heritable changes in gene expression patterns or phenotype that are not dependent upon changes in the nucleotide sequence of the underlying DNA. What's a more accessible definition? And this was written by one of my former colleagues at UF in 2001, and he defined epigenetics as the genetic information, in other words, the DNA sequence, provides the blueprint for synthesizing the molecules of life, while the epigenetic information provides the instructions on how, when, and where this genetic information should be used. Okay? And the most general definition, maybe not the most accurate, but gives you a good feeling for what we're going to talk about, is epigenetic mechanisms are mechanisms that regulate DNA function. Okay, DNA doesn't do anything until it's instructed to do something, and that set of instructions are the epigenetic instructions of the cell. And just to give you a perspective also about diseases and the effect of epigenetics in disease, it's a very short list of human diseases that appear to have an epigenetic component. The most obvious and the most well-studied is cancers. There's a very significant role of epigenetics in cancers, particularly in the silencing of tumor suppressor genes in tumors. Then there are a number of syndromes that have a clear epigenetic basis, and the one that my lab works on is Angelman and Prader-Willi syndrome. But there are also a number of more common widespread diseases like asthma, autism, diabetes, psoriasis, Alzheimer's, alcoholism, schizophrenia, and so forth that also appear to have an epigenetic component. So you can see that epigenetics has its fingers in many, many diseases and consequences. So to give you a little bit more perspective of what epigenetics is, there are two instruction books for life. And this is the code or the term that was used when the Human Genome Project was completed. And that is, we have an instruction book, the genetic book of life, which is the genetic code, all our A's, G's, C's, and T's. Okay? But on top of that, we have what we now know is an epigenetic code also, which is being characterized by the Human Epigenome Project. And the epigenetic code regulates transcription, DNA replication, DNA repair, DNA recombination, and RNA processing, all of the processes that go on in the nucleus of a eukaryotic cell. So what are these epigenetic instructions in a cell? Well, to give you some idea of what those are, I have to give you a quick refresher course or perhaps an introductory course on what gene regulation is, and particularly what chromatin structure is. Because the heart of epigenetic regulation appears to be the regulation of chromatin structure. So what is chromatin structure? Well, we'll talk about mammals primarily. So every mammalian cell, every cell in our bodies, we have about 2 meters of DNA, 6 feet of linear DNA that has to get packaged into a mammalian nucleus that's 10 or 20 microns in size. Okay? So that is the function of chromatin, is to compact this long linear length of DNA in every single cell into this very small nuclear volume in a mammalian nucleus. How is that accomplished? It's accomplished by winding our DNA around a package of proteins called histones into a structure called the nucleosome. So our linear DNA is packaged into what are called nucleosomes that form beads on a string in our DNA. So our DNA is linear, gets wrapped around this package of histones twice into this what looks like a string of pearls. Okay? And this nucleosome is the fundamental structure of packaging in the eukaryotic nucleus. And this is what it looks like in an electron microscope. Literally looks like a string of pearls. The string being naked DNA, the pearls being this cluster of histones, which I'll talk about in a second. Okay? So this is the first level of packaging of our linear 6 feet of DNA in every single mammalian cell into this beads on a string. And this structure compacts our DNA from 6 feet of linear DNA about sevenfold, so to about 10 inches worth of beads on a string. So the beads on a string, as I said, compacts about sevenfold. And then there have to be obviously higher levels of structure. And what's thought to be the next level of packaging of our DNA is what's called the 30 nanometer fiber, in which this linear beads on a string gets further compacted into a thicker fiber, the structure of which has been controversial and in dispute for at least the last 30 years. And 30 years later, we still don't really know what the structure of this 30 nanometer fiber is, or whether or not the 30 nanometer fiber actually exists in a real living eukaryotic cell. So this is the presumptive, the most popular structure of the 30 nanometer fiber, in which the beads on a string get zigzagged, and then the zigzag is twisted into another helix, and that further is thought to compact the structure of the beads on a string so that eventually all of our DNA fits into a eukaryotic nucleus. And this is literally what we know about packaging of DNA. We, in fact, don't know very much. Here's our linear DNA. It gets packaged into beads on a string, which we all agree on. 30 nanometer fiber, still controversial. And we virtually know nothing about what higher order structure of packaging might occur above a 30 nanometer fiber. So for years and years, as long as I've been in the field, packaging above beads on a string has been controversial and still is really quite unknown. But somehow all of this, our 6 feet of DNA, gets packaged into our nucleus. However, the problem is that all of this genetic information that we have, all 6 feet of DNA in our cells, having to package that into a small volume has consequences. The consequence being DNA compacted into chromatin into a mammalian nucleus is inherently inaccessible and repressed. The fact is we take all of the genetic information, we package it at such a high density that none of the cellular machinery can get to it. The transcription machinery, repair machinery, replication machinery, and recombination machinery simply can't get to the DNA because it's so tightly packaged. So what's happened over millennia of evolution is that mammalian cells have evolved mechanisms to open up chromatin, to make it accessible to the transcription machinery so you can turn on a gene and transcribe it into RNA, to open up origins of replication so you replicate the DNA. And so that's what epigenetics is. It's the regulation of chromatin structure and regulating the accessibility of DNA and opening up or increasing the accessibility of regulatory sequences in DNA to overcome this repressive effect of packaging all of this DNA into a mammalian nucleus. Okay? So let me tell you about histones, because these are one of the keys in epigenetic regulations. Remember, that's the package of proteins around which our DNA is wrapped in the beads on a string. Well, There are four core histones, H2A, H2B, H3, and H4. They associate into an octamer that consists of two copies of each of the core histones. So that every histone octamer has two copies of H2A, two of H2B, two of H3, and two of H4. And it's this histone octamer around which the DNA is wrapped in the beads, in our beads on a string. Each of these histones has what we call an N-terminal tail at one end of the protein, shown here. This is the globular domain. It's the globular domain of the protein that around which the DNA is wrapped. But these N-terminal tails can undergo a variety of chemical modifications. They can be acetylated, methylated, phosphorylated, and ubiquitinated, and undergo other modifications. So for those of you who are biology majors, this is the amino acid sequence of the N-terminal tail of histone H3. This is the amino acid sequence of histone H4, the N-terminal tail of histone H2A and H2B. And what you see is that these individual amino acids, arginine, lysine, serine, they can be methylated, acetylated, phosphorylated at each of these different positions. And the key here is that specific modifications are associated with specific cellular states. So for instance, methylating, putting three methyl groups on this lysine, lysine 4 of histone H3, so you get lysine trimethylation of histone H3, that is associated with transcriptionally active genes. As is acetylation of histone of lysine 27 on histone H3. Acetylated lysine 27 is also associated with active genes. However, trimethylation of lysine 27 is associated with transcriptionally repressed genes. Okay, so if you can see this, hopefully where I'm going, the various combinatorial patterns of histone of modifications of these N-terminal tails dictate the function of the underlying DNA. So this has actually been called a histone code, meaning combinatorial differential modification, chemical modification of these N-terminal tails of these histone molecules around which the DNA is wrapped dictates the function of the associated or underlying DNA. So this is part of this pattern of post-translational modification, chemical modification of these N-terminal tails constitutes part of the histone code and the epigenetic code that regulates DNA. It regulates DNA function. Okay?
So different yes. molecules can control different levels of expression?
Yes. So all of these epigenetic mechanisms not regulate whether a gene can be turned on or turned off, but also regulate the level at which they're expressed, low, high, medium, and so forth. So as you can see, there are a vast number of different combinations of histone modifications that can be in any given nucleosome. So it's this combination of post-translational modifications that function, at least in part, to regulate the function of the associated DNA. Okay, so this was termed about a decade ago the histone code. I'm not sure anybody really believes there's a strict histone code, but very clearly the pattern of histone tail modifications is associated and dictates the function of the underlying associated DNA. So these post-translational modifications, the chemical modification of these histone tails, regulate chromatin compaction and DNA accessibility. So here is beads on a string, or this is a bead, and the N-terminal tails actually stick out from the bead and they undergo modification. And part of what these N-terminal tails here do, so they're the fuzz on our little balls here showing the 30 nanometer, I'm sorry, showing the beads on a string, part of what they do is facilitate the compaction of the chromatin fiber. Okay, so we really don't understand exactly how all of this is occurring because it is actually quite difficult to study. But somehow, the pattern of post-translational chemical modification of these histone tails dictate the accessibility of the DNA, but not only that, dictate what other proteins associate with this chromatin and further regulate chromatin. So this is the so-called histone code, an epigenetic code for regulating genes. That's at least part of it. Okay, this combination, the combinatorial pattern of chemical modification of histone proteins. So this is a very highly idealized vision of how this might work. And so what we're talking about is regulating the accessibility, the openness of the chromatin, the openness and the accessibility of our DNA. So here's a gene that is either turned on or is capable of being transcribed. It's open. The DNA sequences are accessible to the transcriptional machinery so that this gene can make RNA, whereas maybe a gene next to it is highly condensed because the chromatin structure is very, very compacted, and therefore the DNA in this gene is inaccessible to, say, the transcriptional machinery, so this gene can't be turned on. So what we're talking about is regulating the accessibility, the compaction, and the structure of chromatin.
So when a gene is read, it's at that level, tenfold, sevenfold compaction.
Well, you know, so we really don't know whether an actively transcribed gene is in beads on a string. It's probably genes that are being very highly transcribed, probably don't have many nucleosomes in the body of the gene, whereas genes transcribed at a much lower level probably do have beads on a string. But again, this is a very highly idealized version. We don't even know if, say, this is actually in a 30 nanometer fiber. This is, you know, the structure of our genes and our chromatin within an intact cell is really a complete black box. We don't know what the structure is within an intact cell. We know what the structure is when we reconstitute in a test tube, but we don't know what it is in a cell. But clearly, beads on a string for sure in a live cell. Okay. So what are the major mechanisms of epigenetic regulation in mammals? One is, well, it's chromatin structure and DNA accessibility that I talked about that is regulated in part by this pattern of histone chemical modifications of histone proteins, but also regulated by this whole constellation of very complicated proteins called chromatin remodeling complexes. These are multi-subunit protein complexes that have whimsical names like switch sniff, NERD, crack, NERF. These multi-subunit proteins come in and they can also move nucleosomes around, displace nucleosomes, open up chromatin. Okay, so part of our evolutionary process has been the evolution of these chromatin remodeling complexes that also regulate chromatin structure, either open or close chromatin structure. Other mechanisms that I'm not going to talk about involve non-coding or regulatory RNAs, a relatively new area of gene regulation, and the one that I'm going to focus on most, which is DNA methylation. This is the chemical modification of our DNA rather than chemical modification of our proteins. All right, so let me talk about DNA methylation now, because this is one of the classic mechanisms of epigenetic regulation. So the question I always ask is, how many different bases are there in human DNA? Yeah, that's a trick question. It's 8. Because it turns out that cytosine can be chemically modified. So in mammalian DNA, you have cytosine. Cytosine can also be methylated at the 5 position to make 5-methylcytosine. And it turns out, not only do we have 5-methylcytosine, we have 5-hydroxymethylcytosine, we have 5-carboxycytosine, and 5-formylcytosine. So we have all these chemical modifications of cytosine. So in total, there are actually 8 different chemical bases in mammalian DNA. DNA methylation in mammals occurs primarily within the sequence C-phosphate-G, C-G dinucleotide. And it's this cytosine that typically gets methylated when DNA gets methylated within a CPG dinucleotide. And the way this happens is cytosines within DNA immediately after replication get enzymatically methylated by a family of DNA methyltransferases, which take a methyl group from the universal methyl donor, S-adenosylmethionine, and remember this molecule because I'm going to come back to it later. It's the universal methyl donor for DNA, RNA, and protein methylation. This methyl group from S-adenosylmethionine gets transferred enzymatically to the 5 position of cytosine to make 5-methylcytosine. So let's say you have or we have an unmethylated DNA sequence somewhere in our genome, and we have the same sequence that's methylated. Okay, and remember, methyl groups primarily recur in the dinucleotide sequence CG, and CG on one strand is CG on the other strand. So both of these get methylated, so you generally have a what's called a symmetrically methylated site. Okay? Methylated cytosine behaves just like regular cytosine. It still base pairs with guanine by Watson and Crick base pairing, and the cell generally treats it just like regular cytosine. However, these methyl groups protrude into the major groove of DNA, and the cell recognizes and distinguishes between unmethylated and methylated DNA, and functionally treat methylated DNA differently than unmethylated DNA. Classic epigenetics. No change, no difference in the DNA sequence, but because this piece of DNA is methylated and this one isn't, they are functionally different. The cell treats them differently because the cell has proteins that recognize and can sense methyl groups in the major groove of DNA and treat methylated DNA differently than unmethylated DNA. So this is classical epigenetic regulation, where there's no genetic difference between two molecules of DNA, but there's a functional difference because one is chemically modified and treated differently in a cell than unmethylated DNA. And what's important here is that densely methylated DNA in promoter regions, the regulatory regions of genes, is typically associated with gene silencing. So typically, hypermethylated genes, hypermethylated promoters, are silenced by the cell, whereas unmethylated promoters generally are not. The other important feature of methylation that really made it important is that there is now a mechanism by which DNA methylation patterns can be replicated from a parental cell to two daughter cells. And this was postulated by my old postdoc advisor back in 1975. What he postulated is, if you have a CpG dinucleotide in a parental DNA, and this cell replicates, what happens is one parental strand will be methylated, but the newly synthesized strand will be unmethylated, and same with the other daughter strand. And if this is unchanged, the next cycle of methylation, next cycle of replication, eventually you will lose or dilute out the methyl DNA signal. So there has to be, if DNA methylation has any consequence or any importance in biology, you would think it has to be mitotically transmissible. And so what Art postulated is that there must be an enzyme that specifically recognizes hemimethylated DNA that methylates the unmethylated strand to restore the symmetrical methylation pattern and also restore the methylation pattern in these two daughter cells that existed in the original parental cell. In other words, you can transmit epigenetic information through cell division. And turns out Art was absolutely right, because the first DNA methyl transferase that was isolated actually has a strong preference for hemimethylated DNA. It's an enzyme called DNMT1 that is now called the maintenance methylase, because it functions primarily in maintaining DNA methylation patterns from parental cells after mitosis to two daughter cells. So this is really important, because now you have a mechanism for transmitting epigenetic information from a parental cell to a daughter cell. So for instance, if a liver cell divides, you have to maintain the same epigenetic information in the two daughter liver cells to maintain those two daughter cells as liver cells, okay, to maintain its phenotypic identity. So many of us regard this paper as really the birth of modern-day epigenetics, the realization that there must be some sort of mechanism that transmits epigenetic information through cell division. And for this, and for also because of other incredible things he did, Art Riggs is now in the National Academy of Sciences. So I need to tell you one more thing about DNA methylation, and that is this concept of CpG islands. As I said, DNA methylation mammals occurs primarily within the sequence CG. But there are certain regions of the genome that have extremely high density of CG dinucleotides. And here's a gene called CST6. Here's the promoter region, because here's where transcription, RNA synthesis starts where this arrow is. So this is the promoter, so-called promoter region, where RNA polymerase binds and initiates transcription. Each of these vertical lines is the location of a CpG dinucleotide. Excuse me. And what you can see here is straddling the transcription start site is a high density of the dinucleotide CpG. This is a so-called CpG island, and many genes have gene promoters have CpG islands associated with them. Okay? And this is actually a tumor suppressor gene called CST6. And what we know now is that hypermethylation of CpG island promoters turns off the associated gene, silences them. Okay? And this is one of the steps in cancer where tumor suppressor genes, their CpG island promoters get hypermethylated and get turned off. Okay, so that's part of the process evolution of cancer. So hypermethylation of CpG island promoter regions is associated with gene silencing. Okay, so that's one of the functions of DNA methylation, is to silence or repress CpG island promoters. And that was what I keep reaching for the slide changer up here. Okay, so what are the other functions of DNA methylation in mammals? Well, you know that DNA methylation is critical for normal development, because if you knock out any of the DNA methyl transferases, the enzymes that actually put methyl groups on DNA, the embryos either die in utero or die shortly after birth, in mice particularly. So it's involved in gene regulation. As I said, hypermethylation of CpG island promoter regions is associated with gene silencing. It's involved in chromatin compaction, and it's also involved in genome stability. I won't go into all the details, but DNA methylation keeps our genomes from being rearranged, either by endogenous viral sequences or by what's called illegitimate recombination. Also involved in genome defense. So many times foreign viruses that invade our cells are recognized by the methylation machinery and also silenced. I'm not going to go into too much detail here other than to tell you this idea that DNA hypermethylation is associated with gene silencing was always sort of what everybody assumed, but it turns out to be much more complicated, because methylation of promoter regions that don't have CpG islands is not closely associated with gene silencing. And in fact, we now have very little understanding of what non-promoter, non-CpG island methylation even does. Okay? And we don't even understand what intragenic, now there's DNA methylation in the body of genes, does. Here are just some of the reports of what intragenic methylation does. I won't go into them. And now we have, in the last 5 years, we now really appreciate there's this other modification, 5-hydroxymethylcytosine, that's particularly prominent in neuronal cells, cells of the brain. We don't know what that does, but it appears to be associated with transcriptionally active chromatin, which is the opposite of DNA methylation. And now we have non-CpG methylation. CpA methylation is very elevated in the brain. We don't really know what that does. So the field has gotten much more complicated. It's not DNA methylation, not simply a mechanism for silencing genes. All right, so what are some examples of epigenetic regulation? And the obvious example is all of mammalian development is an epigenetic process. Because remember, we start from a single fertilized egg, and during the course of differentiation and growth, we differentiate, our cells differentiate into brain cells, liver cells, bone cells, muscle cells, skin cells. The genome doesn't change during this process of differentiation. The DNA in a brain cell is exactly the same DNA that's in a liver cell. What's different is different subsets of genes are expressed in brain cells and in liver cells to give brain cells its characteristic, liver cells its characteristic. So there's no change in the DNA. So this is classic epigenetics. All of mammalian development is an epigenetic process, because our DNA doesn't change, but our epigenomes change during the course of development. Okay? And then the other processes that I won't talk about are X chromosome inactivation and genomic imprinting. These are the two early classical systems of epigenetic regulation. The last thing I want to talk about before I talk about the consequences of epigenetic regulation is what happens during early mammalian development to DNA. So what's plotted here is the course of embryogenesis from fertilization to, say, an adult out here, and this is the level of genome-wide methylation in the cell. at fertilization, you have the mature oocyte that has its own oocyte-specific DNA methylation pattern genome-wide, and the sperm has its own sperm-specific DNA methylation pattern that makes it sperm. Okay? But at fertilization, the fertilized egg now has to de-differentiate and become totipotent, so it has to erase all of the DNA methylation patterns that told the egg to be an egg, and the DNA methylation patterns that tell a sperm to be a sperm. That all has to be completely erased, and that's exactly what happens as in the very early stages of embryogenesis, DNA methylation patterns are almost completely erased. And then at about the time of implantation of the blastocyst, DNA methylation cells become remethylated as cells differentiate into different lineages, hematopoietic lineages, neural lineages, you know, liver lineage, muscle lineage. Every single cell type then remethylates into a pattern specific to that cell type. So you have liver-specific methylation patterns, brain-specific methylation patterns, and so forth. So during early development, particularly, you have this dynamic erasure and resetting of methylation. And the point I'm trying to make here is that thus the early embryo may be particularly susceptible to environmental alteration of the epigenome. So during this whole course of dynamic changing, erasure of methylation, resetting of methylation, these embryos may be particularly susceptible to environmental perturbations. Okay? Diet, effects of environmental toxins, environmental pollutants. Okay? So this is a real area of interest. What does the fetal environment undergo when you're exposed to different environments, and how does the fetal environment alter this process of erasure and particularly resetting of DNA methylation patterns?
Do you know how it erases it or changes it into?
Yeah, so there's a very complicated mechanism for erasure of DNA methylation patterns. In the sperm, in one of these, it's just dilution. As the cells divide, there's no maintenance methylation. So there's a mechanism I showed you before. If you don't have a maintenance methylase, the methylation pattern gets diluted. I forget whether it's in the sperm or the egg, where there's actually an active demethylation. Okay, so the point being made here is that during early development, our epigenomes may be unusually susceptible to environmental influences. All right, so let's now talk about epigenetics and disease. And some of the questions that we're really interested in asking: do the underlying mechanisms of certain diseases have an epigenetic component? Do they change histone modification patterns? Do they change DNA methylation patterns? Do certain environmental conditions, whether it's diet, pharmaceuticals, environmental contaminants, stress, drug addiction, you name it, stably alter DNA methylation patterns and ultimately contribute or alter our disease risk and susceptibility? Okay? Do changes in our epigenome confer and alter long-term disease risk and disease susceptibility? Does aberrant DNA methylation contribute to the disease phenotype by stably altering normal patterns of gene regulation? And can epigenetic effects of environment and diet be transmitted to the next generation? An extremely controversial topic, okay? Because if those of you who have ever studied science history know the name Lamarck, who was totally discredited 150 years ago, not so fast, my friend. I think the evidence is increasing that Lamarck may have been at least partially correct. And I'll touch upon that shortly. Okay, so can your environment or diet alter your epigenome and stably alter patterns of gene regulation in specific tissues? So this is what I'm going to focus on now. How our environment, particularly our diet, alters the epigenome and potentially alters our long-term risk for disease. And particularly, that maternal diet or dietary conditions in utero. Okay, so this is just some of the more dramatic papers of the tens of thousands of papers that have been published on epigenetic in the last decade or two. So here's an unusual one: essential role of histone methyltransferase. So this is an enzyme G9A that puts a methyl group on histones in cocaine-induced plasticity. Cocaine administration in mice reduced levels of histone H3 lysine 9 dimethylation in one area of the gene via repression of this histone methyltransferase, G9A downregulation enhance a preference for cocaine, demonstrating a crucial role for histone methylation in long-term actions of cocaine. So epigenetic effects of drugs, okay? And about a month ago, when we were writing this book chapter, I actually typed in PubMed, our database of the life sciences literature. I typed in the terms epigenetics and drug addiction, and there are almost 2,000 papers on that particular topic alone. Epigenetic programming, my maternal behavior. This one knocked me off my chair when I read this in 2004, came out of Nature Neuroscience. They showed that maternal nursing and rearing behavior, that is, mothers, this is in rats, licking their pups and grooming their pups, and what's called archback nursing in rats, had an epigenetic effect on their offspring. They showed that maternal nursing and rearing behavior of offspring affected the DNA methylation pattern of the glucocorticoid receptor in the hippocampus of their offspring that persisted into adulthood. So think about that. How your mother raised you affects the DNA methylation pattern of the glucocorticoid receptor in your hippocampus, and it stays altered into adulthood. The results suggest a relationship between epigenetic regulation, glucocorticoid receptor expression, and the maternal effects of stress response in offspring, because this pup licking and grooming reduces cortisol levels and reduces stress in pups. Okay, so stress has an epigenetic effect on your brain, and it affects you for your whole life. Thus, epigenetic states can be established through early behavioral programming and persists into adulthood. Okay, so let's talk about one of the really interesting experiments done in mice showing how diet can affect, how your epigenome and epigenetic regulation can affect phenotype. Okay, this is in a mouse model called the agouti mouse. Oh, I'm sorry. So I need to really quickly give you a crash course on one carbon metabolism. All right, so here, remember the molecule I told you about, S-adenosylmethionine, that's a universal methyl donor that is the donor for DNA methylation. Well, this complicated biochemical pathway is all set up to synthesize S-adenosylmethionine. It includes components called the amino acid methionine, folate, folic acid, which is in all of our cereals and grains that we eat every day, vitamin B12, betaine, choline, zinc, vitamin B6, vitamin B12. Well, people thought that maybe you can change DNA methylation patterns through diet by dietary supplementation with what's called a methyl supplementation diet that contains methionine, folate, B12, choline, betaine, zinc, and B6 and B12. Okay, so this is the methyl supplementation diet I'm talking about because it contains all of the precursors and the cofactors that are required to synthesize S-adenosylmethionine. All right, so here is the agouti mouse, this model system that I'm going to talk about. Here are five mice. These beautiful yellow mice are agouti mice. These animals are genetically identical. Okay, obviously they're not epigenetically identical. Not only do these agouti mice have this beautiful yellow coat color, later in life they are really sick animals. They get obese, they have diabetes, and they die early. So yellow coat color, as beautiful it is not good for the mouse. Okay? And the reason these mice are different is because the agouti gene, which governs coat color, has been disrupted by the insertion of a virus called an intracisternal A particle. It's a retrovirus that inserted right upstream of the agouti gene in these mice. And what happens is this virus takes over the regulation of agouti, and so agouti, instead of being expressed only in certain sections of the fur, this agouti gene is expressed in all cells in the mouse, which is not good for the mouse. Okay? However, this intracisternal A particle is susceptible to regulation by DNA methylation. And so what happens is methylation of this intracisternal A particle silences the IAP and allows the normal expression of agouti in most of the cells in the that are associated with fur. So different levels of methylation of the IAP are what dictate the agoutiness of these mice. The more methylation in the IAP, the more yellow the coat, the less methylation, the more brown and wild type normal the code. Okay? So you have the spectrum of different degrees of methylation that are reflected by different degrees of agoutiness in the coat color of the mice. All right? Now, what this group did was to say, well, you know what? If this IAP and coat color, the resulting coat color, is regulated by methylation, can we change coat color and change methylation by feeding these mice a methyl supplementation diet? And that's what they did. They took agouti males, mated them with normal black-coated females, but one group was unsupplemented, the other group got a methyl supplementation diet that consisted of folic acid, B12, choline, betaine, and methionine. All those components of the one carbon cycle that eventually lead up to S-adenosyl methionine. They fed one group this methyl supplementation diet and then scored the coat color from full yellow to sort of intermediate levels of agoutiness to pseudo-agouti, which is brown. And what they found was that the maternal diet epigenetically altered the phenotype because the distribution of coat color was different in these offspring than these offspring. And I'll show you the data in a second. So remember, it's methylation of the IAP that's regulating coat color. So the shift in coat color was correlated with an increase in methylation. So here are the data. So the control diet, this is full black, this is full agouti, and in between, and this is the distribution of the various levels of, say, agoutiness in the offspring. This is the methyl supplementation diet offspring, and what you can see is there's been a distinct shift in the distribution of coat color away from agouti to black, suggesting that the methyl supplementation diet triggered hypermethylation of the IAP because it's now silenced. Okay? So this is now, remember, the offspring weren't fed this diet, their mothers were. So maternal diet epigenetically altered the phenotype in the offspring.
Did that affect the diabetes?
Almost certainly. Yeah, because you don't get the agouti phenotype without late life obesity and diabetes. Yep. So what a mother consumes during pregnancy can have epigenetic and phenotypic effects on her offspring. Okay? So, not only are what you eat, you are what your mother ate. All right? Think about that. Now, close on the tails of that paper was a paper from a study from Randy Jertl's lab that looked at the epigenetic effects of bisphenol A. Does anybody want to know what bisphenol A? Been reading the popular literature?
Water bottles.
Yes. BPA is a high production volume chemical used in the manufacture of polycarbonate, hard plastic bottles, and epoxy resins. It's a present in many commonly used products, including food and beverage containers, baby bottles, and dental composites. 90% of the US population pees detectable levels of bisphenol A. We're all exposed to bisphenol A. Detection of BPA in 95% of human urine samples clearly attests to the widespread use of BPA and widespread human exposure to BPA. So, does BPA have epigenetic effects? You betcha. I say, are there detectable epigenetic effects of maternal exposure to BPA on offspring? So they did the exact same experiment with the agouti mice. Female mice mated with agouti males were fed during pregnancy a control normal diet or a control diet supplemented with BPA, and then they assessed the distribution of coat color and DNA methylation at the IAP in offspring. So here are the data. The control diet, the distribution of coat color is shown in gray, and the coat color distribution is shown with a BPA supplemented diet is shown in black bars. And what you see is a distinct shift in coat color toward the agouti phenotype. Okay. And what I don't have here, but what that paper also did, is what they showed is that if you fed pregnant females both BPA and the methyl supplement methyl supplementation diet, you could suppress the shift of coat color caused by BPA. In other words, the methyl supplementation diet canceled out the epigenetic effects of BPA on the agouti locus. Okay? So diet, maternal diet. So what your mother eats does matter. So maternal BPA exposure shifts offspring coat color toward yellow. Therefore, maternal BPA consumption has epigenetic effects on offspring, which can be suppressed by co-feeding with the methyl supplementation diet. So here is now the next issue. So if you can affect phenotype and the epigenome in offspring, what happens? Can the offspring now transmit that same phenotype to the next generation without ever having the next generation or the offspring being exposed to the same environmental conditions or toxins? In other words, is the epigenetic effect of maternal diet transmissible through multiple generations? Okay, this is controversial, but there is a growing literature showing that the answer is probably. All right, this is the title of a paper that came out in 2010. The title doesn't really do the paper justice because it's sort of in science-ese, but what they did is they took male mice and fed the fathers a low-protein diet, 11% protein rather than 20% protein. Okay? And the low-protein diet was given from weaning all the way to sexual maturity. And the low-protein males were crossed with control females, and the controls were just control males and control females. And then they looked at the livers of the offspring of the fathers that were fed a low-protein diet. And remember, the fathers in this case had no role in rearing. All they did was donate their sperm. Okay? All they did was transmit their DNA to their offspring, had no environmental or rearing role in this. And what they found is that paternal low-protein diet altered cytosine methylation patterns in the liver of offspring, increased the expression of cholesterol biosynthesis genes, and decreased levels of cholesterol esters in their offspring. So paternal diet also has had an epigenetic and biochemical effect on offspring. It's as though for the father's diet altered the offspring's epigenome to maximize the survival of the offspring under conditions of low protein diet. Okay? So offspring of male rats fed low protein diet showed elevated and reduced liver expression of many genes, hundreds of genes, many involved in upregulation of genes involved in lipid and cholesterol biosynthesis relative to controls. Epigenomic profiling of DNA from livers of male offspring showed numerous, and we're talking hundreds, but modest changes in DNA methylation in response to a paternal low-protein diet. So father's diet had an epigenetic and biochemical effect on the livers of their offspring. So not only does what your mother eat make a difference, what your father eats apparently also makes a difference to your epigenome. Thus, and I won't go into thus paternal diet can affect lipid and cholesterol metabolism and alter DNA methylation patterns in offspring. Okay? And these are long-term changes that persist throughout or into adult life. What about other diets? What about high-fat diets? Okay, here's a chronic this is in Nature 2010, chronic high-fat diet in fathers programs beta cell function. These are the cells in your pancreas that make insulin, beta cell dysfunction in female rat offspring. So I'll just summarize this. Paternal high-fat diet resulted in early onset of impaired insulin secretion and glucose tolerance that worsened with time in female offspring, not in males. Female offspring also showed altered expression of over 600 genes in pancreatic islet cells and altered DNA methylation of this gene involved in in pancreatic cell lines, that this gene is altered in pancreatic cell lines. So this again shows that paternal diet also has a phenotypic and epigenetic effect on offspring. Now, this is the paper in 2005 that triggered this very controversial and very interesting idea of epigenetic transgenerational effects of environment and diet. And this is from Mike Skinner's group at Washington State University, where he actually exposed rats in utero to the environmental contaminants vinclozolin and methoxychlor. They are herbicides. I think vinclozolin is used in primarily in the wine industry. And it induced in offspring a decreased, this is in males, sperm number and viability later in life. These effects were transmitted through the male germline to nearly all males in subsequent generations through F4, four generations. The phenotypic effects of this exposure was transmitted through at least four generations without any of the subsequent generations being exposed to any of these environmental contaminants. The effects on reproduction correlate with altered DNA methylation patterns in the germline. Thus, he concludes that environmental factors such as toxins, environmental toxins, contaminants may have the potential to alter the epigenome of the germline, propagating these changes through subsequent generations and potentially altering disease risk in subsequent generations. Okay? So this is still quite controversial, but there's an accumulating evidence for this sort of epigenetic transmission through multiple generations.
But
okay?
Finite, though. But through a finite number of generations.
Well, you know, he's only talked about going through F4. These are really experiments to do, expensive because you have to maintain these mice through four generations. So it's just hard even to get them to F4. I've only heard him talk about carrying as far as F4. I don't know how far he's taken them yet. He got a head start on everybody else. But this is very controversial. Many people don't believe him. I have to say that there's an accumulating and groundswell of evidence that suggests there is epigenetic transgenerational effects of environment. Okay, and I have a collaborator at the University of Florida who has this very interesting mouse model for repetitive behavior in autism. And what he's shown is that these methyl supplementation diets given to the mother can suppress the repetitive behavior in their offspring. And if he mates their offspring, the offspring of the offspring also don't show repetitive behavior. And remember, only the mothers were exposed to the methyl supplementation diet. So it's hard to deny that there are, at least for some systems, epigenetic transgenerational or transgenerational transmission of these epigenetic effects. So again, what parents consume can have epigenetic effects on their offspring. And I've heard more than one of my colleagues talk about being contacted by lawyers whose clients are disaffected children, I guess, who were not happy with the way their life turned out. And they're looking for grounds for suing their parents and their grandparents for their parents and grandparents' irresponsible lifestyle that led to the consequences of their failed lives. Honestly, really. Yeah. I've heard two epigenetics colleagues tell me that they've been contacted by lawyers asking that very question. Is this grounds for suing for their clients suing their parents for their irresponsible lifestyles? Yeah. So now, are there examples of epigenetic effects of parental diet in humans? Because obviously these are hard experiments to do, and we want to know if this may be true in animals, is this true in humans? Well, unfortunately, the experiment was done in World War II. This is the famous Dutch famine of November 1944 to 1945. So what happened in 1944 is the Dutch resistance started blowing up the German supply lines during the end of World War II, and in retaliation, the Germans cut off all food and fuel to parts of the Netherlands for a period of 9 months. So the Dutch population in these cities, and I forget whether it's Rotterdam or Amsterdam, for a period of 9 months were particularly calorie and protein restricted from November 1944 to May 1945. And obviously during this Dutch famine period, women were either pregnant going into the famine or many of them became pregnant during the famine. And so the Dutch government and the Dutch medical community have followed their offspring for many decades since then. So you have people, offspring that were exposed late in gestation, mid and early gestation, and people have now looked at the effects of the Dutch famine on these offspring. So these are people who were in utero during some part of the Dutch famine.
Excuse me.
And what they have found collectively is later in life, exposure to the famine during gestation correlated with higher rates of obesity, hypertension, cardiovascular disease, reduced renal function, antisocial behavior, schizophrenia, impaired glucose tolerance, etc. in offspring. And this is just some of the papers. There's a whole literature on the Dutch famine showing the consequences of dietary restriction in humans. Early onset of coronary artery disease after prenatal exposure to the Dutch famine. A possible link between prenatal exposure to famine and breast cancer. Impaired insulin secretion after prenatal exposure to the Dutch famine. Prenatal exposure to wartime famine and development of antisocial personality disorder in early adulthood. Okay, so clearly, phenotypic effects of famine in utero.
Did they find the same thing with the Biafran population?
No, that hasn't. There are two other populations they've looked at. One is there was an ice storm in Canada in which there was a famine, and also in China. In recent history, there was a famine in China, and that has also been studied. But this is by far the most well-studied cohort of individuals. So potential epigenetic effects of maternal diet on long-term offspring in humans. So what we need to do now we have a phenotype. Is there any epigenetic effect of the Dutch famine and on DNA methylation patterns in offspring? And this is a paper in PNAS 2008, which found that offspring of the Dutch famine showed lower DNA methylation in the imprinted IGF-2 gene, and this is a gene involved in fetal growth particularly, and this DNA methylation pattern, this change in DNA methylation pattern, persisted through six decades after exposure to the famine in utero. These data suggest that environmental conditions in utero can trigger alterations of the epigenome that persist throughout life and potentially affect long-term disease risk and health outcomes. And then this group has done subsequent studies, and they found that DNA methylation changes, both increases in DNA methylation changes at multiple genes involving growth and metabolic disease in these famine subjects. So the phenotypic and epigenetic effects of dietary restrictions in humans, I think, is fairly well established now by the study of the Dutch famine. And this all comes back to this theory of fetal origins of human disease, sometimes called the developmental origins hypothesis, that proposes that fetal nutrition or the fetal environment affects long-term health and disease and risk and susceptibility for diseases in adulthood. So what happens to you early in life, particularly in the fetal or environment in utero, has an impact on your disease susceptibility later in life into adulthood. I'll get to that too. Okay, so and so since we know there's no evidence that famine, for instance, is mutagenic or changes our DNA, these long-term changes are most likely to have an epigenetic basis. Okay, so getting back to your question, can epigenetic effects of the prenatal or early postnatal environment be transmitted to subsequent generations in humans, or is there evidence for transgenerational epigenetic effects of environment in humans? So the obvious answer is yes. And this is, again, part of the Dutch famine study. So what they showed is that these are the pregnant females that were pregnant during the course of the Dutch famine. This is their offspring. And the offspring of the offspring, the grandchildren, and remember, the offspring and the grandchildren were all normally fed. These grandchildren all show decreased birth weight, or have a statistically significant decreased birth weight. So this phenotypic effect, or the exposure in these pregnant females, has at least an effect through two generations, okay, in humans. So the conclusions are: epigenetic effects of environmental conditions early in life have the potential for altering disease susceptibility and risk, and affecting long-term health. There's growing evidence that certain epigenetic effects of environmental conditions early in life can be transmitted to subsequent generations and have transgenerational effects on health, and that mechanisms of transgenerational transmission of epigenetic changes is not clear, though altered DNA methylation in the germline is one possibility. RNAs in germ cells, also another possibility. But the mechanism by which these transgenerational effects of epigenetic changes, the mechanism by which that occurred, not really clear. So I'd like to leave you with this one thought of this widespread application for epigenetic analysis and the potential for our epigenomes for affecting either positively or negatively the long-term risk and susceptibility to diseases in life, later in life. So what are the effects of diet and epigenetic effects of diet and nutrition and dietary supplements? We've gone through some of those. Epigenetic effects, environmental toxins, talked about that. But what about pharmaceuticals? What about those of us who've taken high blood pressure medicines for the last 20 or 30 years? Are there any epigenetic effects of long-term drug exposure and pharmaceutical intake? Epigenetic of other environmental factors and conditions, and epigenetic components of other biological processes, drug addiction, stress, learning, behavior, development, lifespan, intelligence, you name it. Okay, there is a likelihood that there is an epigenetic component or an epigenetic effect of those conditions on us and our epigenomes. So the last thing I'll briefly tell you is actually, so my lab is actually looking at the epigenetic effects of prenatal ethanol exposure in a mouse model for fetal alcohol syndrome. So what we've done is used our collaborator, Marita Heaton, in the Department of Neurosciences at UF, used her mouse model to analyze changes in fetal DNA methylation in brain tissue in response to maternal alcohol consumption. And these are our other collaborators, Henry Baker and Alberto Riva. And what we're finding is that we're finding changes at least, I think the last number was 7,000 different cytosines in the cerebral cortex of offspring that have been exposed to fetal alcohol in utero. So this is, as I said, we are one of probably 10,000 or more papers that have come out in this field. Everybody is now interested in what are the epigenetic effects of our environment, diet, all sorts of conditions. So with that, I think I'll stop and take questions. At least if you didn't understand all the hardcore epigenetics, maybe at least get you thinking about it. Thank you.